Hachette Audio presents Adventures from the Land of Stories box set, The Mother Goose Diaries and Queen Red Riding Hood's Guide to Royalty, written and read by Chris Colfer. Queen Red Riding Hood's Guide to Royalty by Her Royal Majesty, Queen Red Riding Hood, with Chris Colfer. To my beloved Charlie, little girls are told if they kiss a frog, they may get a prince. I kissed a prince and wound up with a frog. Then again, I've never been good with instructions. But I wouldn't have it any other way. I love you. Introduction. The Prince in Me. Fellow Hoodians, admirers, royal subjects, and royal rejects, thank you for choosing my first book, Queen Red Riding Hood's Guide to Royalty, as your listening selection. I can't imagine the anticipation, enthusiasm, and admiration coursing through your feeble bodies as you hold your very own copy. Before you excite yourself to the point of needing medical attention, I must thank you for the hours and/or days I assume you waited in line to purchase it. And to ease those uncontrollable thoughts of unconditional gratitude, just know the pleasure is all mine. I'm certain your simple minds are all wondering the same thing. Why would our astonishing queen go out of her way to write a book? I thought the same thing when I first sat down to write it. The truth is, wherever I go, there are always crowds of devoted followers asking me the same questions. Your Majesty, how do you do it? How do you manage to govern a prosperous kingdom, endure countless adventures, and maintain such beauty and pose so effortlessly? Since I do not have the time, or the patience, to respond to each individual, I decided to compile my numerous secrets into this book to answer all your pressing questions at once. You're welcome. The idea first came to me one evening while I was lounging in my newly refurnished library. I had just finished a charming and silly little play called Hamhead by William Shakeyfruit. Oh, excuse me, Hamlet by William Shakespeare. I was looking for another humorous read from the other world when I came upon a delightful book called The Prince by Nicole Macarena. Or was it Niccolo Machiavelli? Well, whatever her name was, I thought it was a splendid story. In summary, The Prince was a guide to monarchy. Isn't that marvelous? It gave helpful hints on managing a government, making the proper alliances, and keeping respectable appearances. The best part of reading the book was realizing I've been doing everything correctly since my coronation, although I doubt that surprises you. However helpful Miss Machiavelli's words were, I couldn't help feeling her book was a little outdated. It may have had its purpose at one point in time, but it isn't relevant to politics today. Just like ruffled bloomers. More on that in my next book, Queen Red Riding Hood's Guide to Style. Since I am the beacon of ideal leadership, I felt it was my duty to give the seminal classic a makeover. Who else could possibly be qualified for the job? For the next several minutes, or however long it takes to write a book, I will combine the concept of the prince with the constant requests of my people and create my own guide for future royals to follow and future royalists to treasure. Again, you're welcome. History will see this guide as one of the greatest literary achievements of our time, because as queen, I have control over what history remembers. So, curl up with your copy in a cozy corner of your own library. Give your servants a list of meaningless tasks so that you aren't bothered. If you have children, tell your nannies to keep them at a ballroom's length distance. Give your House of Parliament, Congress, or Progress the day off. Relax and enjoy this historical triumph. Chapter 1. Beneath the Hood. I believe that before taking advice from someone, it's important to know exactly whom you're taking the advice from. So before we dive into matters of economy, politics, image, charity, and all the other nonsense a king or queen deals with, it's important that I introduce you to the real me. Naturally, this may confuse your delicate heads. After all, my profile is engraved on every coin, statues of me stand on every street corner, and I'm certain my portraits decorate your modest homes. You couldn't be unfamiliar with me if you tried. However, the familiarity I speak of has nothing to do with my exquisite appearance. I'm talking about the woman beneath the hood. For the first time in my reign, I'm going to give you, my people, a glimpse into my personal life, my mind, my heart, and my impeccable soul. My past may be one of the greatest stories ever told, but rarely do I speak about it myself. Unless you work at the castle, then you may hear me reminiscing 2 or 3 times a day. There is more to my story than you realize, and once I share it with you, I believe you'll admire me even more than you do now. Yes, it's possible. This may be hard to believe, but I was once as you are now. Just like Cinderella, I was an exceptional young girl cursed by humble beginnings. I was born to 2 simple farmers in the Northern Kingdom long before the Crawl Revolution separated us from the North. More on that in a moment. Please stay focused. My parents mistreated me horribly, which is why I've chosen to distance myself from them today. It saddens me to tell you that my childhood was filled with misery. Every morning, I was forced out of bed before noon and ordered to do horrific tasks like chores and schoolwork. I was assaulted by rules and standards. I was restricted with curfews and bedtimes. Every day, my mother and father would say horrible things to me like, "You can't have that," and "No." Despite my declarations that I deserved much better treatment, my parents ignored me, and the nightmare continued. As an only child, I had to endure it all alone. My parents must have known deep down I was extraordinary, because whenever I asked if I was going to have any brothers or sisters, they'd reply, "You're enough." Unlike Cinderella, I did not let my unfortunate origins affect my sanity. You'll never see me talking to mice. Despite the mistreatment I received from my parents, I never stopped believing I was meant for bigger things. And I'm not talking about that summer when I gained weight and needed new clothes. My weekend visits to my granny's house were my only sanctuary from my terrible home life. Granny never treated me like a servant or a prisoner, but saw me as the exceptional human being I am. She treated me to candies, toys, and naps. She offered me the compassion and respect my early years were missing, always saying encouraging things like, "Have another cookie," and "Yes." I honestly don't know how I would have survived without her. Granny made my first hooded coat. She chose a fabric the exact color of my name and christened me Little Red Riding Hood. I think the coat helped her remember who I was when I showed up at her house. Poor Granny has never had the best memory. In a serendipitous twist of fate, the people of my future kingdom were also suffering. The villages and farms of the Northern Kingdom were constantly under attack by wolves, with no salvation in sight. Queen Snow White's stepmother was on the throne at the time. She was so busy with her magic mirrors and attempted murder, she ignored her people's requests for protection. Hence the name she is now remembered by, the Evil Queen. When the little boy who cried wolf was murdered, it was the last straw. The villagers and farmers banded together and started the Crawl, citizens' riots against wolf liberty, revolution, with their sights set on establishing their own kingdom away from the Evil Queen's jurisdiction. My granny was very active in the revolution and caught a nasty cold during one of the demonstrations, a hunger strike, if I recall. We knew she needed to get her strength up, so my mother packed a basket of goods and sent me to deliver it to Granny's house on the other side of the woods. I would like to take a moment to reiterate this. My mother sent her only daughter into the woods alone in the midst of wolf attacks and a revolution. See what I mean? Terrible parenting. It was during this journey to Granny's house when I infamously encountered the big bad wolf himself, and the rest of my extraordinary story took place. While we're on the subject, I have something to get off my chest. Over the years, I have been criticized for telling the big bad wolf that I was headed to my granny's house, followed by directions of how to get there. However, this should not be a testament to my judgment, but once again to bad parenting. My mother and father never sat me down and said, "Red, if you meet a wolf in the woods, don't give him your itinerary." If they actually cared about my well-being, they would have properly warned me. And another thing. As I said earlier, my granny was involved in several revolutionary protests in those days. She was always dressing up in weird outfits. So when I walked into her bedroom and saw the big bad wolf lying in her bed, I had no reason to believe it wasn't her. Any logical girl would have thought the same thing. Phew, I'll sleep much better knowing that I've put that in writing. I assume you know what happened next, but I'll tell you anyway. The big bad wolf gobbled me up in one bite, and I met up with Granny in his stomach. We spent 2 days inside the wolf's belly, but it really wasn't as unpleasant as one would imagine. Once we got used to the smell, it was rather warm and comfortable. Luckily, Granny had managed to grab a deck of cards as the wolf swallowed her, so we improved our gambling skills as we awaited rescue. Eventually, my parents grew concerned and asked a hunter to help them look for me. The hunter found the wolf at Granny's house in the exact spot he had eaten me. Apparently, Granny and I were too much for him to digest, and he was experiencing a miserable food coma. The hunter killed the wolf with one slice of his axe, and Granny and I fell out of him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.